Here we discuss the sequence of events when we discuss the role of neutrophils and macrophages as a line of defense in inflammation. Okay, the first line of defense is constituted by the tissue macrophages. As we have already discussed, macrophages are everywhere. Okay, they have different names and different tissues with a slight change in their characteristics in different tissues. For example, we have histiocytes in the skin. Those are macrophages. We have microglia in the brain. We have Kupffer cells in the liver. We have alveolar macrophages in the lungs. Okay, so they are everywhere, and owing to their physical presence in every tissue, they constitute the first line of defense against tissue injury and subsequent inflammation. Okay, they are already there, and they respond to injury within minutes. So this is just a matter of minutes that tissue macrophages and the affected tissue are activated, and the source of activation, the cause stimulus for activation, is the products of inflammation and infection. Okay, so within minutes they are activated, and we have discussed earlier that macrophages are far more superior in terms of phagocytic ability to neutrophils. They have far more phagocytic potential. Okay, and their killing tools too are more sophisticated as compared to neutrophils. At the same time, they serve the function of antigen presentation to lymphocytes. Okay, so that makes them superior to neutrophils, and since they are already present in every tissue, they constitute the first line of defense. They become activated and start their phagocytic action. At the same time, they elaborate a variety of chemical mediators, including interleukin-1, tumor necrosis factor, and granulocyte monocyte colony stimulating factor, the granulocyte colony stimulating factor, and the monocyte colony stimulating factor. We will discuss the role of those individual chemical mediators in bit greater detail later, but here we move on to the second line of defense. Okay, that is constituted by the invasion of neutrophils, and that is just a matter of hours. Within 1 hour, as soon as 1 hour after the event, after injury, neutrophils are mobilized to the injured tissue. And we have already discussed that neutrophils are the most abundant cells, white blood cells, in circulation. So it takes very little time for them to be able to reach the injured tissue. And it is within a few hours that there is significant buildup of neutrophils in the injured tissue. So in circulation, if the normal TLC is 4,000 to 11,000, within a few hours, more and more neutrophils are mobilized to the injured tissue, so that in the injured tissue we have a buildup of neutrophils. And at the same time, in circulation, systemic blood vessels, their numbers increase, a term we call neutrophilia. This is all because the products of inflammation manage to enter the bloodstream, okay, and cause the release of neutrophils stored in the bone marrow. They are the most abundant ones, and accordingly, their storage in the bone marrow is in similar proportions. Okay, so they invade and complement the already present tissue macrophages in combating the invading microbes or any other damaging influence. The third line of defense is a second wave of macrophage invasion. We already discussed that macrophages are superior to neutrophils in terms of phagocytic potential, in terms of sophistication of their killing tools, and in terms of antigen presentation to other to lymphocytes. Okay, so it is good if we could have more and more of macrophages in the injured tissue. Okay, but this response, that second wave of macrophage invasion that constitute the third line of defense, is a bit slower to respond. Okay, I don't need to, perhaps I don't need to mention again that tissue macrophages are the products of monocytes. So far they are in the circulation, we call them monocytes. When they manage to get into the tissues and there is a slight change of their properties as well, we call them macrophages. So monocytes, for monocytes to be mobilized from their storage site in the bone marrow, it takes time. It takes a few days to a few weeks. Okay, so we may write here, this is a matter of few days. This is a slower response, and it may peak in few weeks. Okay, still later, while we need neutrophils and macrophages in the injured tissue to fight against the invading microbes or any other damaging influence, we need more and more of them. Okay, but their storage in the bone marrow is limited. Okay, so that we can manage the second line of defense, neutrophil invasion is a second line of defense through release of already stored neutrophils in the bone marrow. But that is a limited resource that will exhaust soon. Similarly, that second wave of macrophage invasion too will last a little. Okay, all those cells already in storage in bone marrow will be exhausted soon, and we will need increased production on part of the bone marrow to compensate their increased demand in such a situation. So the fourth line of defense is constituted by the bone marrow that increases its production of neutrophils and macrophages. Okay, and this capacity is quite significant. The bone marrow may increase its production capacity up to 5-folds, rather up to 20-folds of normal. Okay, and this process is elaborated here in this part. Okay, if you could just suppose for a moment for this uglier creature to be a macrophage. Okay, those macrophages release chemical mediators, interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor. And the first two, interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor, are critical in mobilizing the neutrophils. Okay? And at the same time, they help transform other cells, like interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor will act on the endothelial cells. They will act on the fibroblasts, and even lymphocytes to help them produce these products. The colony stimulating factors that, so that macrophages produce those, the fibroblasts, the endothelial cells and the lymphocytes under the influence of interleukin-1 and tumor necrosis factor also produce those, and that will mediate or facilitate the fourth line of defense. That is increased production of neutrophils and macrophages by the bone marrow. So this is how things proceed. There is a concept of layered defense. Different inflammatory cells invade the injured tissue in a certain sequence. Okay, and that's perhaps all. But before moving ahead, we need to tell you one more thing. This whole inflammatory response, inflammation, is meant to protect the tissues against invading microbes or other damaging influences. But this is not essential for the inflammatory response to be able to eradicate or eliminate the threat effectively each time. Okay, at times it is effective and it helps restore the state, the previous state of health of the affected tissue, of the injured tissue, within a few days. okay? But eight times, the invading microbe too is very smart, and that inflammatory response makes the matter worse, so that the whole story, this whole sequence of events keeps on repeating itself. Okay, and after a few weeks, if the whole process stays for more than few weeks, this is where we call it chronic inflammation. And as we already mentioned, inflammation itself can be far more damaging than the actual invading microbe. Okay, so this is where things can get worse, and we may need support from outside. Like, we use anti-inflammatory drugs, we use steroids, and we may use specific therapies to target the invading microbe or any other damaging influence that varies from case to case. Thank you very much.